I got five stones, picked them up off the ground. I got five stones, gonna turn things around. I know it sounds crazy, but the giant's gonna fall. I got five stones, getting ready to fly. I got five stones, with the Lord on my side. The devil doesn't like it, but the giant's gonna fall. Hello, Five Stone Church.
Come on, is anyone excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Yeah. God, we come to you today ready for what you have. In fact, would you just lift your hands all over this place? God, we know that you have something in store for today. God, your word says where two or three are gathered, your presence is there. God, I proclaim that your presence is in this place. Your presence to change a life is in this place. Your presence to make a miracle happen is in this place. Your presence to change a circumstance, to make everything that's busted, that's tore up, that doesn't seem like it can get better. God, that presence that can make that better is in this room right now. So God, we start not by offering our complaints. We don't start by offering our problems. God, we start by lifting our praise to you. For you're great and you're worthy to be praised. Can you say that? You're great and you're worthy to be praised. God, we come to bless your name in this place. We come to seek your presence. God, we pray that you would have our praise. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Everybody say it. Come on, put your hands together with us.
Good news.
to worship in this place. That God showed up whenever you were at rock bottom. That God made a way whenever you were giving up. That God showed up whenever you were done with everything. When no one else was there, can anyone testify that my God was always there for me? Did anyone testify in the verse that says, my God will never leave me, he will never forsake me? Come on, can anyone testify in this place? Things we can do is stop worshiping. One of the worst things we can do is stop talking to Jesus when things get hard. I'm not looking to have the kind of faith that I give God praise whenever I think he deserves it. I'm not going to give God praise whenever there's evidence in my life, there's proof in every little thing, because I'm going to look beyond the moments that I'm ready to give up. I'm going to look beyond the moments whenever I get betrayed. I'm going to look beyond the moments whenever I get stabbed in the back. I'm going to look beyond my feelings. I'm going to look beyond my thoughts, and I'm going to rest and sure in the blessed assurance that Jesus is mine, that he paid a price for me. I'm going to worship no matter what my situation says. I'm going to worship whenever the bills don't add up. I'm going to worship whenever everything is coming against me that shouldn't. I'm going to worship whenever people keep saying the things that are hurtful. I'm going to worship even when I don't feel like it. Because our God is worthy of our worship. Amen. Amen. I'm going to worship through it. I'm going to push past the surface. Push into the presence of God. What if I told you that there was a worship that we could tap into that is not affected by what you see? There's a place that we can go to in worship. That's getting into the presence of God, where no matter what our situations say, we can lift hands high because we're free. No matter how we feel, we can lift our hands high because we know that God is with us. The series that we're in right now, Pastor Jeff, is breaking down the Holy of Holies, breaking down the true mode of worship. What's amazing to me is if you really look at pursuing the presence of God, encountering the presence of God, with everything he's portrayed up here, with the Ark of the Covenant representing the Holy of Holies, with the lampstand that's representing the Holy Spirit, with everything that does, notice how it changes every single one of your senses to fully focus on the presence of God. It's not distracting. It dims the light so it's not distracted by other things that are around you. It changes the atmosphere of the room so that you are solely focused in the presence of God. What if I told you that you can achieve, that you can enter into a place of pursuing Jesus that's not detrimental, it's not determined by situations that are around you? What if I told you that you can seek a place in your relationship with God where you can be at a place where it's just you and Him? The Bible talks about how the angels cried, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Holy is the Lord." The Bible says, one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that He is holy. Challenge you today to press into what God is wanting to do today. It's very clear that there's a lot of things happening that the enemy wants to distract what God has planned for today. But I don't choose to focus on distractions. I choose to focus on the presence of God because He is holy, because He is worthy of our praise. So I challenge you, would you press in with us today? Would you continue to lift your hands right now? Right now, would you just lift your hands? Would you begin to cry out to Jesus in this place? Father, we're here for You. Father, we're here for what You have for us. God, we're not here to be distracted. We're not here to worry about our little things. God, we're here to press into You. We're here to focus on Your presence. We're here to focus on what You have for us. So God, we invite You, overwhelm us today. Let Your presence flood this place right now. Let Your presence begin to walk down the aisles today. Let Your presence begin to fill the seats today. God, let Your presence encounter us today. God, we're here for You. We're here for You. You are holy. You are worthy of our praise, God. You are worthy of our praise. God, may we see You today. God, may we see You in this place. Come on, I challenge you, press in. Press into His presence. Always be. worshipers arise in this place. Lord, we say you are holy. Think of all you've done. I say you're worthy one more time. Say you are worthy. Oh, so worthy. You are worthy. Thank you.
worship you, Lord, around your throne. Give you glory, Lord. Give you our worship, Lord, around your throne. With all of heaven, we join our voice. We open our heart today, lifting our hands and lifting our voice to say, you're holy, you're worthy. Oh, so holy you are, holy Lord of all. We worship you. Nothing else to do. We worship you. Because you loved us. You loved us. Oh, how you love us. Oh, we worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. A father and a son. This is the picture that God gave us. God is not a human. We're made in His image, but He's not a human. God is a spirit. And it's the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, three distinct parts of God that work together in perfect love. But He chose to display to us His love in the image of a Father and a Son. That while we were still sinners, before we chose Him, He chose us. While we were sinners, while we were broken in this relationship, He chose us. And as we've been talking about in the old system of worship, it just could not bring us back into a face-to-face encounter with Him. We're going to talk about that today. Pastor Cameron, keep playing. Just a little louder. In the old system, there was a veil, a thick veil that separated the Ark of the Covenant from anybody except the high priest. And there is where the face-to-face encounter was happening with God. But we couldn't go there. But God said, I'll send my Son. My Son will be the sacrifice. My Son's blood will not just cover sin, but it'll take it away because He's my Son. My Son will be pure in heart. He'll never sin. He'll pour Himself into humanity, but He'll never sin. He'll stay in communion with me in the holy place. And my Son, when He does all of this, and when on the cross He said, it is finished, the debt is paid, the Bible tells us that that veil ripped in half from top to bottom. Not from bottom to top, but from top to bottom. God ripped that veil and said, I want you now to come in. I don't want anything to separate those who I love from being face to face with me. For God so loved the world, He gave His Son. That whoever would believe, you would not perish, but you would have everlasting life. And everlasting life has everything to do with Him. Pastor Tommy, I want you to pray for us today. People here and people that will watch online. Everybody's somewhere in this journey. And sometimes life gets us distracted from Him. Sometimes life wears us out and we stay back when God is saying, I have made it I've paid it. I want you to come in and encounter me face to face. Sometimes people stay back, but God doesn't want them to stay back. I want you to pray for us today that no matter what's going on in people's lives, that they would know today that God loves them and that he's made a way for them and that he's working even right now for their good if they'll just believe. Pray for us.
God, I first just want to thank you for everything. Thank you for waking me up this morning. Thank you for giving me the ability to do what I do. Thank you for putting the sun in the sky. Thank you for everything that you've done for me. And thank you for everything you're going to do, God. But God, I just pray that wherever we are in our journey, I pray that you put a burden on our heart. Put a burden and a longing to want more. And God, I just pray that everybody sitting here, everybody that's going to watch this online, will feel that burden and that longing to just wanting something more. And God, I pray that that will usher us into your presence. And God, I just pray that nobody feels like they're not good enough for it. And God, I just pray that you be with us in this journey. It's not easy. It's not hard. It's hard. It's not easy. But God, I just pray that you walk with us through this journey and give us that longing. And God, I just pray that the people around us don't matter. And the voices in our head that convince us not to come to the altar and not to go into your presence, God, I pray that all of that would be silent. And I pray that it will just be filled with your voice, calling us to do the things that you've called us to do, leading us in the direction you've called us to go. And God, I just pray that you walk with us every day, you walk with us through this journey. And God, I just pray that you give us peace. Give us peace in our situations. Give us peace in the loud, distracting situations, God, because these distractions are just to keep us away from you. And the longer we're distracted, the further we get away. But God, I just pray that you silence those distractions. Remove those distractions from us so we can focus on you and enter the presence that you tore the veil, you sent your son, and we can enter that presence now and just be with you. It doesn't have to be a concert, doesn't have to be a conference, doesn't have to be a church service. It can just be me and you, God. And I pray that everybody here gets to that place where it's just you and them. I just ask all of this in your name. Amen.
You know, I think it's so interesting how God is. And on a day like today, when we're trying to worship the deepest ever, that we come in and I don't know if God did it or the devil did it, but things are stripped down. Things are stripped down. And will you still worship God without a 22-foot, you know, wall dancing for you and putting all the words up for you? Will you still worship the Lord? Will you still worship the Lord when the sound's a little weird because of a lot of things going on? Will you still worship the Lord? Will you still worship the Lord when things are broken? Because you said it, even if it's stripped down, if all we had, I was determined today that if all we had was a candle and an acoustic guitar, I'd say, here I am to worship. Would you say that? Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, and altogether wonderful to me. Come on, do it with me. Say, here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that. One last time, say, I'll never know how much it costs to see upon that cross. With no music at all, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Would you join me for the next 30 seconds and just love him in your own words? In your own words, God, I love you. Come on, for what he's done for you personally, your testimony, worship him for that. Worship him for what he saved you from, what he pulled you out of, what he turned around for you, where he made a way where there was no way. Worship him for that. Worship him for the things he protected you from, the things that you should have gotten, but he showed you his mercy and held it back. The things that he blessed you with that you didn't deserve because of his grace and love. I worship you for all of that, God. The truth is today, if it wasn't for Jesus, if it wasn't for God, some of you would be tore up today. But he's healing you up. Some of you would be divorced today, but God has done a miracle. Some of you would be lost today, but he's done a miracle. Some of you would have harmed yourself or someone else, but he's done a miracle. Some of you would be homeless today, but he's done a miracle. Some of you would be dead today, but he's done a miracle. For you, he's done a miracle. Amen. Come on, somebody. He's done a miracle for you. If he's done something for you, let's give him a hand clap of praise today, because he's worthy. Because he's worthy. Because he's worthy. Because he's worthy. He's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy. Now I'm going to dare you to do something today. I'm going to dare you to share how good God is with somebody else. I'm going to give you time to get out from your seat right now and find at least 5 people to tell them God's been better to me than I've been to him. Come on, tell somebody.
enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. Right? I will enter his courts with praise. And I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I used to sing that in church, man, all the time. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Shout for joy to the Lord and worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Like, I'll praise him anywhere. Good stuff. And know that the Lord is God. We are his. We are his people, sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Enter his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues throughout all generations. And if you've been here at all, you know that we've talked about what worship is. Worship comes from two words, which is worth and quality. To worship anything is to esteem it as worthy, as valuable. I'm going to worship this. This has quality in my heart. I'm going to worship this. This is worth what I am giving. Throughout this process, I've been talking to you about the Old Testament system of worship, the sacrificial system of worship. The Old Testament tabernacle of Moses, and getting our minds wrapped around what worship used to look like. Coming in through the gate with thanksgiving and praise looked like a family coming in with livestock, with animals, coming for them to be sacrificed at the brazen altar. Because the wages of sin is death, the gift of God is life, but that's through the shedding of blood. There's life in the blood. So that was worship, coming in as a family, coming in through that outer court, bringing something that you've nurtured and fed and raised and cleaned up after, bringing it to sacrifice. That's a sacrifice of praise. God, I want the sin in my life to be atoned for with this sacrifice of praise. And that's a picture of what it might have looked like as animals are sacrificed and a burnt offering going up before the Lord. Now, past that, we've talked about worship and coming to the basin. We're going to get back to that right now. Just reminding you, though, that this is all about a picture of worship, and it's about Jesus. Jesus said, I'm the gate. I'm the gate. Come, if you come through me, the gate, you can be saved. To the brazen altar, he said, that he was the sacrifice, the body of Jesus sacrificed once and for all. His blood would not just cover sin, it would take sin away. So sin would not be the barrier anymore that keeps you apart from God. Jesus was the gate, Jesus was the sacrifice. And the Bible tells us as we come to the basin again, that if we confess our sins, not just make the sacrifice, but if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just and will what? Forgive and, what's the other part?
Purify
us. There's a purification process that happened in the old system where the priest, after the sacrifice were made, the priest had to come to the basin, as we said, and he would have to purify himself. He would have to wash his hands, wash his feet, and purify himself. These are levels of worship. The gate, the sacrifice, the purification process. All of this before you can go into the holy place. The holy place was the place of communion. This is where the communion happened with God. in this holy place. And again, all of this, a picture of Jesus. Jesus says, if you see on the screen, that Jesus is the bread of life. In the holy place, this was always to be maintained by the priest in the old system. 12 loaves of bread, symbolic of the 12 tribes of Israel, God's people, God's chosen people, but also symbolic ultimately of Jesus. I'm the bread of life. And the bread of life, he is the word made flesh. The word of God is the bread of life. Jesus is the bread. He's the word. And whoever comes to me will never go hungry. It's a different kind of hunger, though. We hunger for things all the time in our life. I'm not talking about food. We hunger for success. We hunger to be happy. We hunger to have things that we want in our heart. Whoever comes to me, the bread of life, will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Over here, the menorah would burn, always to be maintained. Oil burning in the lamps had to be maintained by the priest. It's a part of worship in the holy place, the communion place, symbolic again of Jesus, because Jesus said, I'm the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. In the old holy place, this would illuminate the holy place. You'd have the bread, you would have the light, and you would have the incense. As Pastor Cameron said earlier, it really hits all the senses. When you come in, you know, the bread is there, and that kind of hits you in your stomach a little bit, and the light is there to illuminate. It hits you through your senses of sight, and then the smell, the incense there, again, symbolic of prayers going up, but again, tying into Jesus, because Jesus said that he sat down at the right hand of the Father and is even today interceding for you. He's praying. His prayers are going up before the Father, even now, for you. And all of this was an Old Testament worship, and then it was a Jesus thing, because the Old Testament was just a foreshadow of Jesus. And the whole process, hear me today, the whole process is to bring you God's object of affection into communion with him. Getting rid of sin as an issue, getting rid of that, being purified, coming into this place of communion with God, and it hits all the senses, and it gets everything. But ultimately, in that old system, as I said, the veil separated you from the actual face-to-face encounter with God, the presence of God. So what is this ark all about? And that's what I want to take a moment with you today, just for a second, is focusing on this ark. Why did God do all this? And what is this ark all about? And why was it here? Behind the veil in the Holy of Holies. And the Bible tells us in the description of this in Exodus 25, you can see it on the screens, that God was very specific about the design of this vessel. And in this vessel, he said, that's where I'm going, my presence is going to be. And he says in the description, in verse 20 of Exodus 25, he said the cherubim, and that's the angelic creatures on the top of the lid there, they are to have their wings spread upward, overshadowing the cover. And the cherubim are to face each other, looking toward the cover. Place the cover on the top of the ark and put in the ark the tablets of the covenant of the law that I would give you. And look at verse 22. There, above the cover, between the two cherubim that are over the ark of the covenant law, I will meet with you. I want you to see that today. Can you see it? I will meet with you. Second line from the bottom. And I'll give you my commands. Ultimately, in worship, I want you to just grasp this for a second. God wants to meet with you. He doesn't want you to stay away. He doesn't want you to be lost. He wants you to come in. He wants you to come in, and he doesn't want you to be burdened by sin, and he doesn't want you to go to hell. He doesn't want any of that. He wants you to take care of that through his provision. He wants you to be purified by water. He wants you to come in and have communion with him, and he ultimately wants to meet with you. Can I tell you today that not a lot of people meet with God? Because not a lot of people are willing to worship him. We're willing to worship out there. We're willing to worship in the outer court. We're willing to maybe come in the year 2024. We're willing to come in and maybe stand up, clap our hands, and sit down, hear 3 points in a poem, and then go, you know, like that. You know, we're not living this life of worship that he calls us to live, where he says, look, I want you to come in and I want you to have communion with me and I want you to meet with me. So God chose this in the old system, the ark. What was in the ark? Let me show you here real quick. And again, in Hebrews 9, it tells you, verse 4, just simply, that in the ark, inside this ark, was a gold jar of manna, Aaron's staff that had budded, and the stone tablets of the covenant. Just real quick. In this vessel, in this temple, through this whole thing, you come to this place, and in this vessel, you would have found the gold jar of manna. Now if you remember, God provided manna in the wilderness to sustain his people. So the manna was there to remember that supernatural provision that happened, that God supernaturally provided for his people. In there, you would also have found the Aaron's staff. Now, Aaron's staff, this is a whole thing that God did. You can go read about it. But the bottom line is that Aaron's staff, it was a wood stick. It was a staff that God chose to come back to life. A dead stick came back to life and budded and produced almonds, produced fruit. A dead stick to show and remind us always that God can supernaturally bring dead things back to life. Everything's also a foreshadow of Jesus. God supernaturally provides for his people. God supernaturally brings dead things back to life. And then the stone tablets that he gave Moses, the law of God, that supernaturally God speaking and to his people of how to come from curse to blessing. That was to be in, and that was in the Ark of the Covenant. And then the lid was placed, and upon that lid was called the mercy seat. Now, that's kind of what I want to give you, just a little bit more of why, before we shift for the end of this whole thing. Why did all of this happen? We know that God wants us to worship. We know that he wants us to come deeper in worship. We know he wants us to commune with him and to be in communion with him here where the word is speaking to us and feeding us, and the light and the Holy Spirit is illuminating, and we're entering in prayer and we're coming to meet with him. The ark, I want you to understand what the ark was all about. The ark was, on the screen, you'll see it, a place of supernatural communication. Now, allow me to deposit into your life for just a moment some hope. What if I could tell you today, I'm not a salesman, I'm just somebody that tries to talk for Jesus, all right? What if I could sell you today the idea that God wanted something more for your life, that he wanted you to come and worship deeper? What if I could somehow say the right words to get you to believe today that there's a deeper place in worship where God wants to supernaturally communicate with you, with you? In Numbers 7, the Bible tells us that place, the ark, was the place that Moses would go, and he would hear the voice of God speaking to him from right there in between the cherubim. That they would hear the voice of God I don't know about you. I've never heard an audible voice before of God. I've heard him speak in a small, still voice. I've heard him speak in my heart before, but I've never heard that audible voice. But God wants us to have a supernatural form of communication with him. That was just a picture of what he wants to give you today. It was also going a little farther, a little deeper. It was a supernatural place of guidance. You can see it on the screens again. A supernatural place of guidance. The ark was something that you didn't want to lose. And there were times in history where God's people lost control of the ark. There was a lot of war that happened in back in those times, and they lost control. But when you had the presence of God, when you had the ark of God, it would guide you. And you can see in Numbers 10 that one example right there where they were traveling. And they were moving forward, and the Ark of the Covenant was going before them. They were carrying the Ark, but the Ark was guiding. God was guiding them to a place of rest. So the Ark is a supernatural place where we hear from God. It's a supernatural place where we get guidance from God. It's also, going a little deeper, a place of supernatural miracles. I don't know about you, but I don't see a whole lot of miracles. Sometimes I see people trying to hype stuff up and trying to make things out to be miracles. Let me take that back. I do see miracles. I see miracles in this house right now. I see lives that have been changed by God. That's a miracle. And there are things that we don't even understand, things that God has done that we'll never even know about until we get to heaven. But I do know that in the Bible, there were things that were undeniable things where, like, God would take a blind man and open his eyes. A man who had never seen before, and God would open his eyes and he would see. I do know that in the Bible, there were examples where God would take somebody who's never walked before and suddenly heal their legs, and they could get up and they could walk and they could jump and they could praise God. I do know of miracles where God has taken a little boy's lunch and multiplied it, and multiplied it, and multiplied it, and fed a multitude, and there were 12 baskets left over when it was all said and done. I do know that God can do undeniable, visibly tangible miracles, but I do know that we don't see it a whole lot in America, and I'm going to suggest to you that we have to go deeper in worship. In Joshua 3, is this instance where they had the ark and they needed to cross over the Jordan River. And the Bible tells us that the Jordan River was at flood stage. But with God's communication and God's guidance, God's miracles were right on the heels of that. And the Bible tells us that when the priests were carrying the ark, as soon as they touched the water with their feet, the water stopped up and stopped flowing. And then the very next verse, verse 17 here, it says that the priest who carried the Ark of the Covenant stopped in the middle of the Jordan River when it was at flood stage and stood on dry ground. Holding the Ark of the Covenant in the middle of the Jordan River so that the whole nation of Israel could come across on dry ground. That reminds me of another story of crossing the Red Sea on dry ground, right? Because when you have the ark, when you have the presence of God, there are miracles. There is communication from God. There is guidance from God. And there are miracles that go with God's presence and with his people. Amen? It's also, the ark is a place of supernatural victory. Because there are battles to fight in this world, y'all. There is an enemy out there who wants to take you out, your family out. He wants to hurt you. He wants to steal, kill, and destroy. But I want to suggest to you that God has something better. I'll throw that shoe. Amen. God has something deeper. God has something better. That he wants you to come into a new place. I'm going to trip and break my neck. Have to have a miracle to get me up. All right. God wants us to come deeper into this place where there's victory. that walks with you. And no weapon formed against you will ever prosper. And no enemy that rises up against you will ever get victory over you. Because why? Because you are in communion with God. And you have his presence with you. And that brings victory into every circumstance. There is nothing that can get victory over you, because greater is he that's in you than he that's in this world. And I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Come on, somebody. The Bible tells us in Joshua 6 of this occasion where after they crossed the Jordan, then they needed to take the city. They needed to get victory for Jericho. And the Bible tells us that they put that ark out there and they had the people out there and they started walking around the city. Wouldn't it be awesome if we could just start walking around the situation and saying, oh, God is about to do it. Just looking at the circumstances saying, oh, God's about to do it. I can see what it looks like, but God's about to do it. God's about to change it. God's about to give the breakthrough. God's about to move. God's about to bring victory into my life. God's about to take me to a new place. God's about to give me a new breakthrough. I'll praise him anywhere. And God told him to start walking. Start walking around it. Start praying around it. Start communing with God. And start believing. The supernatural things were about to happen. And as they walked around, the Bible tells us in the next verse 4 there that they had the priest carrying trumpets of ram's horns in front of the ark. But the ark was in front of them. And they go, and they're walking, and they're praying. And they go around on the seventh day, 7 times. They go around it, and they go around it, and they go around it, and they blow the trumpets. And the Bible tells us that victory came, that the walls began to crumble, and they began to fall. The obstacles began to crumble, and they began to fall, and the enemies began to scatter, because there's victory that goes with the presence of God when we commune with him in a deeper way. When you hear the long blast of the trumpets and the whole army gives out a shout, the wall of the city will collapse and the army will go up, everyone straight in. I'll tell somebody, you've been wandering too long and God's about to help you to go straight in to the place that he's got for you. Because this is a supernatural thing. This whole thing was supposed to be a supernatural encounter with God. Coming into the gate isn't enough when there's something supernatural waiting. Standing at the altar and making a sacrifice of praise is not enough when there's something deeper and supernatural waiting. Coming and saying, God, cleanse my heart. I got junk in my heart that needs to get out of my heart. God, cleanse my heart so that I can come deeper, God, into communion with you, God, because you can't get here unless you come here, and you can't come here unless you get rid of that junk in your heart. But it's not enough to stay here when God has something supernatural waiting for you. Even getting into this place, and you can get into this place and say, oh, I like it here. It smells good, and it feels good, and I can see the bread and I'm sure it tastes good, and I like the light, and I like this, but it's not enough when you know that on the other side there's something deeper and something supernatural that God is wanting to meet with you, and he's wanting to talk to you, and he's wanting to guide you and bring victory for your life. And in that place, it's a place of supernatural transactions that are happening. In Leviticus 16, I want to read this to you. The high priest in the old system would take a censer full of burning coals from the altar and 2 handfuls of finely ground fragrant incense and take them behind that veil. and put it on fire before the Lord. And the smoke of the incense will conceal the atonement cover of the tablets of the covenant of the law so that he will not die. Can I tell you, somebody, today you need to understand how incredibly powerful this is. The presence of God, the power of God. This is just a foreshadowing of what he wants to give you today. He doesn't live in a box anymore. He wants to live in you. But he wants you to worship him in spirit and in truth. Truth is the word of God. His spirit guides us in our life of communion and prayers with God. If the priest didn't come through all of this stuff right, and if he didn't bathe everything in prayer right, he would die right away. You can't short-circuit worship, folks. You can't make it out to be something it's not. The old system was the old system, and it was a foreshadow of Jesus who would bring a new covenant. And in the new covenant now, he still calls you to this place of worship, personally. The priest, as I'm closing, Pastor Cameron's coming back, the worship team's getting ready to come up. The priest would take some of the bull's blood with him, and with his fingers, he would sprinkle it on the front of the atonement cover. He'll sprinkle it 7 times on the lid of the ark, the mercy seat. He'll slaughter a goat for the sin offering for the people and take the blood behind the curtain and do the same there. He'll sprinkle the blood on the atonement cover in front of it. And the Bible says, in this way of worship, he will make atonement for the sins of a nation that rebelled. I'm going to go out on a limb, and I know there's a lot of hype. There's a lot of tension. There's a lot of stuff in our world right now, in America going on right now, a lot of polarized stuff, a lot of false stuff, a lot of lies, a lot of stuff trying to sway people's hearts and minds, and we're more divided as a nation than we've ever been. And when it comes down to it, I'm telling you, the church better not be left. They better not be right, but they better be right in center step with God. The church needs to be the church. The church needs to be the church, and we need to be worshiping him in spirit and in truth. And I'm telling you what, there's one thing I know about the truth. The truth extinguishes lies. The church, I know this is a tangent moment right here, but I'm just going to tell you, first of all, you're here to make a difference. So I'm going to tell you, you need to make a difference. Your voice needs to matter. Your vote needs to matter. The church needs to have a voice. And we need to make our voice known that we stand for what's right and what's true, and we're led by the Spirit of God, and we've prayed about it, and we believe God is up to something. That's free. Because this is a place, this is a deep place where transactions happen with God. The blood splattered on the mercy seat would bring forgiveness to a nation. There's no more blood to be shed. Jesus shed all the blood that needs to be shed for us. But that part of worship is up to you. To get face to face with God like that. And I'm going to give this to you as we're closing. In Hebrews 9, I put this whole thing in because it's so important. It's verses 11 to 15. I want you to read it with me. Jesus. And he brought this new covenant. He did away with all this old stuff and brought this new covenant for you. And it says in Hebrews 9, verse 11, that Christ came as the high priest. Remember before, only the high priest could even dare get that close to the presence of God. And now God tore that veil, and now God is saying, you, I want you to come to that place now. I want that kind of communion with you. And Jesus did it first. He went in as the high priest of the good things that are now already here. He went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not made with human hands. That is to say, is not part of this creation. Verse 12, he did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once and for all by his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. Verse 13 says, the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of heifers sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so that they're outwardly clean. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, how much more will he cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death so that we may serve the living God? Guys, today, if you're wearing a red shirt on this Red Shirt Sunday, it says serve over your heart. And I'm going to tell you, that's a hard place for people in this world to get to, Pastor Cameron. It's hard for people to get their heart into worship. And when we realize all that he has done, and we realize that there's miracles waiting at that place, there are miracles waiting that he wants to do, but it has to be us coming to him in spirit and in truth and bringing our hearts before him and saying, God, I want to live for you. I want to serve the living God with my life. And verse 15 says, for this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant that those who are called may receive, right here, the promised eternal inheritance. Now he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. There is an inheritance that God is ready to give to his people. If you've ever received an inheritance before, you usually have to wait until somebody that loved you dies so that they can bless you in their death. And I'm here to tell you that that's worship. That somebody who loved you so much died so that you could have your inheritance and you don't have to wait. It's available right now. The veil is torn right now. He's not living in that box anymore, but he's saying, come to me. Come to me. I want to dwell in you. I want you in the same supernatural things that happened with that box. He wants to do in your life. He wants you, your presence. You carry the presence of God to work. You carry the presence of God to the community. You carry the presence of God into your home. You carry the presence of God into every battle. I feel the anointing of God to tell somebody, stop staying at the gate. Stop staying at the altar. Stop staying in this funky place with your heart and get deeper in worship to the place where the living God is living in you. And you are seeing miracles. After miracles. My what now to you today is so simple, but it's not. Worship deeper. Worship deeper. Praise team, come up. Worship team, come up. Guys, what's holding you back? What's clogging up your heart? What's keeping you from the word? What's keeping you from the path that he is illuminating? What's keeping you from face-to-face prayer with God? What's keeping you from seeing the miracles happen? Whatever it is, The choice is yours. You choose to go deeper, or you don't. You choose to say, what God has in store for me, I don't care what it costs. I don't care if I come down to an altar, ladies, I don't care if I cry all my makeup off. I don't care if I wrinkle my clothes, if I mess up my hair. I don't care if I look a certain sort of way to somebody. I am not going to miss out on the miracle that God has in my life, for my family, for my community, for my nation. I'm not going to miss it. So, the worship team has been pressuring me about this song that we're going to do, about how good this song is, because it talks about miracles. Me and Pastor Cameron, we have these deep theological talks, right? And I say, Pastor Cameron, I can't feel comfortable doing that song yet, because I'm not going to tell you something that I believe is going to point you the wrong direction, right? I love you too much to point you the wrong direction. There's not a lot of that in church these days, people that will tell you the truth whether you want to hear it or not, right? But I said, I can't do this song yet because I'm not going to sell you this song that tells you that all you need to do is sing these words up on the wall and miracles are going to start flowing in your life. Doors are going to start flinging open in your life. That everything's just going to work out for your life. That everything's going to be great. I can't tell you that. And I won't sell you that. But on this final week of worship, I'm going to tell you, it's available if you'll worship deeper. Miracles. If you're willing to go the distance with God, He is still a supernatural God. He will still, young people, I'm telling you, He will speak. Older people, I'm telling you, it might have been a long time since you've heard it or you've never heard it. God wants to speak to you. He wants to supernaturally guide you. He wants to bring victory into your world. He wants to help you. Miracle after miracle. Yeah. He wants to save your family. He wants to put people's names down in heaven instead of hell. There is a place that is open to you. So as we do this song today, I'm bringing this service and this series to a close. And I'm gonna be pushy enough to say, what are you gonna do with it? 4 weeks of talking about that. What are you gonna do with it different than what you've already been doing? Here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna challenge you. This basin is still here. And if there's something in your heart that's holding you back, come down here and do this as a sign to God. Say, I want to have a clean heart. I don't want anything to stand in the way of what you want to do in my life. I want to clean my heart, God. I'm going to tell you, I've been doing that. I don't want anything in my heart to keep me from what God wants to do. And the altar is here. If you need to make a sacrifice to God, say, God, I need to lay things down that I've been carrying. I need to lay it down. If you need prayer today, the altars are open. God wants to meet with you And there's a place for him to meet with you. If you can't physically get to the altar today, make the altar where you're at. But don't use that as an excuse today just to stay back. If you physically can't get here, if you're online and you can't get here, look, make an altar where you're at. But bring your heart to God face to face. And I'm going to pray this over you. God, for anybody that will worship deeper, for anybody that will want you like that, my prayer today, with a clean heart, I come before you today, God, to say, speak to us. Lord, with a hunger in my soul, I come to the table of bread today to say, God, feed us your word and change us and challenge us, God, and illuminate us, God, and fill us with your spirit, God. And God, we bathe it all in prayer that we can commune with you and see you face to face and live for you, God, and see you do miracle after miracle and open door after open door. God, I pray it over your people today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, let's worship. Would you stand with us? Prayer team, would you make yourself ready in case anybody needs prayer today? Let's worship.
Storm to be still, and it did.